الصلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي
because Allah refers العبد من عبادنا. Perhaps you might want to do find this work of homework for me to find out whether or not any jinn was ever referred to as abd. To find out whether any angel like Jibreel alayhi salam was ever referred to as abd. It should not be long for you to do that research for me. But he is referred to as abd. And so the Quran, listen to the word, I'm using it carefully. The Quran portrays him as a human being. I don't think as a jinn or an angel, because I'm not aware of the jinn or the angel being referred to as abd. But if I'm wrong, do please correct me. So he's portrayed in the Quran as a human being. And he is a human being who possesses knowledge of such a degree that a prophet of Allah should go to him and ask to be allowed to follow him, to learn from him. That Allah should choose Musa alayhi salam to be the prophet who would follow him, to learn from him. I suspect, and of course when we give an opinion, we say Allah knows best. But we are allowed to offer an opinion. I suspect that Musa alayhi salam was chosen to send a message to them who declare that they are the elite of mankind, that they are the ones who have the most knowledge of deen, that heaven is reserved for them, and that the rest of mankind have a status which increasingly looks like cockroaches. And so a message being sent because Musa alayhi salam is chosen as the prophet who would go to him and ask him for permission to be allowed to follow him, to learn from him. Whether he is alive or he is dead, I don't know. I would like to say something more in answer to that question, but I fear that I will be misunderstood, so let me say it right there. And so we turn to the Quran normally and then to the Hadith to explain the Quran on the subject. In this case, however, it is curious, and I want to suggest to you that it is not by accident. It is something which provoke thought that although Khidr alayhi salam is in the Quran, he is not mentioned by name. And although Dajjal is the mastermind of Akhir al-Zaman, the mastermind, and his fitna will be the greatest fitna that mankind will experience from the time of Adam alayhi salam to the last day. It seems perhaps that many people are not aware of that, because most people don't seem to be interested in the subject of the Dajjal. I've hardly found it of any interest, or serious interest. Curious, isn't it? The mastermind of the Akhir al-Zaman is Dajjal. And yet the name Dajjal does not appear in the Quran. And that's your homework. Why has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala left out the name of Dajjal in the Quran? Is it by accident? If you believe it was by accident, buy a one-way ticket to the moon. Don't come back. Why is the name Khidr alayhi salam not mentioned in the Quran? Is it by accident? No, it's not. There must be a reason why these two names are left out. And yet these two names are connected. And we want to begin tonight's lecture by establishing the link and the connection between Dajjal and Khidr alayhi salam. Is there any? This book, Surah Al-Kahf in the Modern Age, answers that question. You remember the rabbis in Medina? You remember the three questions? I'm cutting corners now to save time. Ask him about the young men in the cave. Ask him about the great traveler who travels to the two ends of the earth. Ask him about the ruh. In answering these questions, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first repeats the question and then answers it. Notice, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْرُوحِ, and then he answers, they ask thee about the ruh, and then he proceeds to answer the question. Notice, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْقَرْنَيْنِ, and they ask thee about Dhul-Qarnayn, and then he proceeds to answer the question. But what about the third question? Why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not say about the third question, and they ask thee about? He does not. It's not by accident. There are no accidents in the Quran for people who think and ponder and reflect over the book of Allah. The questions were tricky. The question about the ruh had nothing to do with akhir al-zaman. But the two other questions were directly linked with akhir al-zaman. And so in answering the questions, Allah separated them to send a message to the rabbis. I understand what you're doing. So the answer for the question concerning the ruh is not in Surah Al-Kahf. No. Where is it? It's in Surah Al-Isra. Not by accident. And when he answers the question about the great traveler, they only asked about two journeys. But Allah knew what was the target of the question. And that's why he spoke about the third journey about which he had not been asked. About which they had not been asked. And it is that third journey which led to Ya'juj and Ma'juj, who are a major sign of Akhir al-Zaman. The question was asking these three questions which only a prophet can answer.
You could have as many degrees as you want from UIA, you wouldn't be able to answer. Only a prophet can answer. And only a prophet could have answered about Gog and Magog, no son, no heirs.
And so the target of the second question was Akhir al-Zaman. And about the, one of the major signs of Akhir al-Zaman, namely Gog and Magog. But they asked the question in such a way that it was, by the way, tricky. When it came to the young men in the cave, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered the question. And when he answered the question, he gave them something extra. In the island of Trinidad, where I was born in the Caribbean, we have a local expression for it. He gave them a lion, something extra. Namely, they didn't ask about the dog, but he told them about the dog. And he even told them how the dog was sitting and where it was sitting. All of these details. It must have stunned the rabbis in Medina. But what was the target of question one? Was it simply the story about the young man and the kid? Was that all? When question two was on Akhir al-Zaman, Gagan Magar. I want to suggest to you, because you're all students and you have inquiring minds, that the target of question one, and Allah knows best, was the Dajjal. Allahumma billah billah. I want to suggest to you that the target of the question concerning the young man and the kid was the Dajjal. And that in answering that question, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose to put the answer at the beginning of Surah Al-Kahf. He put the answer about the great traveler at the end of Surah Al-Kahf, not the beginning. But he put the answer about the young man in the cave at the beginning of Surah Al-Kahf. I think وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنْ ذِي الْقَرْنَيْنِ should be somewhere around 80-something or 90. But the beginning of the answer on the young men in the cave comes almost at the beginning, maybe number 10, verse number 10 of the surah. Why is this location of the answer so important? Because the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, recite the beginning of Surah Al-Kahf in one hadith, and the end of Surah Al-Kahf. And in another hadith he mentions the first 10. Both are hadiths. For protection from the fitna of Dajjal. Thereby establishing a link between what is contained at the beginning of Surah Al-Kahf and Dajjal. And the answer to the question is located at the beginning of Surah Al-Kahf. And so I suggest to you that the target of the question concerning the young men in the cave was the Dajjal, and I argue that point in this book. And it is in this Surah Al-Kahf of the Quran, which is the surah that Allah's Messenger said, recite it on the day of Jum'ah. Some people call it Friday. You know where that name came from? For those who have only one eye. Most people today have only one eye. The Dajjal also has only one eye. And they use the name Friday without ever thinking twice. And they pronounce themselves to be rightly guided people, and they come to Imran Hussein and lecture to him about what is right guidance. And yet, they use the name Friday without thinking twice. Well, let me tell you, Friday is the day of fry. And fry is a Scandinavian goddess. So he said, recite Surah Al-Kahf on the day of Jum'ah. And if you do that, you'll get nur. From the Samawat to the up, and that nur will stay with you until the next Jum'ah. You all know that, all of you.
So you're all reciting Suratul Kahf from the day of your... I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand, you're well. What I have done in order to encourage people, and please don't declare bid'ah for me, please. Just in order to encourage people, and you might want to do the same thing. Because we live in an age in which the Quran has now been abandoned. Yes. وَقَالَ الرَّسُولُ يَا رَبَّ إِنَّ قَوْمِ اتَّخَذُوا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ مَهْجُورًا. They made hijrah from this Quran today. So we gather on the night of Jum'ah, which precedes the day of Jum'ah. A nice group. I did it in Trinidad, I'm doing it here in Malaysia and KL. And we have the collective recitation of Suratul Kahf. And after the collective recitation is finished, then I give a little talk on Suratul Kahf. And then we perform Salatul Isha, and then we have some nice refreshments. So you might want to do the same thing in your hostel room or so. Recite this surah on the day of Jum'ah, and you'll get nur from Allah. And that nur is linked to what I began the topic with, epistemology. Epistemology. Khidr alayhi salam represents the answer to Dajjal. Khidr alayhi salam gives you the methodology of studying Dajjal. Khidr alayhi salam allows you to understand and to penetrate the reality of the world in the age of Dajjal. This is the importance of Khidr alayhi salam. Number one, methodology for the pursuit of knowledge. When we turn to the hadith, which is where we normally do, on the subject of Khidr, we have to be very quick now. It's in I choose the hadith from Sahih Bukhari.
Indeed, we have suffered great tiredness.
يعني لقد لقينا من سفرنا هذا نصرا. But Musa عليه السلام never felt tired on this journey until they had passed the rock. The servant brought the food. The servant said to him, "Do you know, while we were by the rock, I forgot to tell you." But the hadith says only shaitan causes him to forget. That the fish comes out of the basket and made its way into the sea in an amazing way. And Musa alayhi salam said, "That is what we're looking for." So both of them then retraced their steps until they reached the rock. And there they saw a man lying covered with a garment. Musa alayhi salam greeted him. And he replied and asked, "How do people greet each other in this land, in your land?" And then Musa said, "And I am Musa." There are other ahadiths which differ slightly from this, but we can stay with this hadith. The man asked, "Are you Musa of Banu Israel?" He said, "Yes." He then continued, "I have come to you so that you may teach me from those things which Allah has taught you." To which he replied and said, "O Musa, alayhi salam, I have knowledge which Allah has given to me, which you do not have, while you have knowledge which Allah has given to you, which I do not have." In other hadiths, this is reversed. And so Musa then asked, "May I follow you?" But he replied, "You will not be able to show patience with me. And how can you be patient concerning things which lie beyond your capacity to understand?" To which Musa alayhi salam then said, "I assure you, you will find me patient, inshallah, and I will not disobey you in any matter." Both of them then set out walking along the seashore, and the boat passed by, and then asked the crew of the boat to take them on board, and the crew recognized Khidr. So they took them on board without any fear. F-A-R-E, fear. And when they were on board the boat, a sparrow came and stood on the edge of the boat and dipped its beak once or twice into the sea and drank. Khidr alayhi salam then said to Musa alayhi salam, "O Musa, my knowledge and your knowledge have not decreased Allah's knowledge except as much as this sparrow has decreased the water of the sea with its beak." Then suddenly Khidr alayhi salam took an agricultural instrument called the azl, which he used for tilling the soil. And he struck the bottom of the boat and made a hole. This is called scuttling the boat, so it cannot be used. Musa alayhi salam was annoyed. "What have you done? They took us on board not charging us anything, and yet you have intentionally made a hole in their boat so as to drown its passengers. You've done a dreadful thing." Khidr alayhi salam then replied and said, "Did I not tell you that you would not be able to remain patient with me?" Musa alayhi salam then said, "Do not blame me for that which I have forgotten, and do not be hard upon me for my fault." So the first excuse of Musa alayhi salam was he had forgotten. And then when they left the boat, they passed by a boy playing with other boys, and Khidr alayhi salam took the boy's head, plucked it out with his hand like this. And so Sufyan, the sub-narrator, just said with his fingertips, as though he was plucking out a fruit. And Musa alayhi salam said to him, have you killed an innocent person who has not killed any person? You've done something really terrible. Khidr alayhi salam said, did I not tell you that you could not be patient with me? And Musa alayhi salam said, if I ask you anything after this, please leave me. I have made too many excuses. And then both of them went on until they came to some people of a village, and they asked its inhabitants for food, and they were refused. They refused to entertain them as guests. And then they saw a wall which was about to collapse, and Khidr alayhi salam repaired just by touching it with his hands. Sufyan, the sub-narrator, gestured with his hands, illustrating how Khidr alayhi salam passed his hands over the wall upwards. Musa alayhi salam said, these are people whom we have called upon, and they have not given us any food, they have not entertained us as guests, and yet you have repaired the wall. If you had wished, you could have at least charged them a price, get a refund on your money. The Prophet added, we wish that Musa would have remained patient, by virtue of which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might have told us something more about this story. Sufyan, the sub-narrator, said that the Prophet said, may Allah bestow His mercy on Musa alayhi salam. If he had remained patient, we would have been told further about their story. In other ahadith, we get the rest of the story, which is located in ahadith. But I want to turn now to the Quran. In the Quran takes up the subject with Musa alayhi salam and the boy traveling in search of Majma'ul Bahrain. And they have the basket and they have the figure. If you look at the commentaries of the Quran, you will find some effort of locating these two oceans. The one commentator of the Quran, which I found most interesting, was Imam Baydawi, rahimahullah, who suggests that these two oceans are not to be understood literally. And it is his right to offer an opinion, Imam Baydawi, and he says Allah knows best. Everybody has done that all through history. Our commentators have always offered an opinion. Nobody ever questioned it, except now. Except now. And so he suggests that these two oceans are actually oceans of knowledge, for example. One being an ocean of knowledge, which is acquired through our senses, our rational faculty, observation, and the other being an ocean of knowledge which is acquired internally, internal knowledge. Whatever that may be, when we proceed further, we're able to understand Majma'ul Bahrain a little better. So let's proceed. When they reached the rock, and they stop to sleep, the Quran informs us that the young man informed the Musa alayhi salam, it was at that place, that the fish jumped out of the basket and made its way to the sea. What is the importance of the choice of a fish? What is the importance of the fish being close to Majma'ul Bahrain, because that's where he met Khidr alayhi salam? What is its significance for Akhiru Zaman? These are questions we need to ponder over. And this one mind of mine is not enough to deal with it. That maybe there is a hint for us of survival being easier if you cross to the sea. But Allah knows better. Once they crossed the rock and they kept on going, the journey now becomes more difficult. Yes, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam did say that in akhir zaman, holding on to Islam would be like holding on to hot coals. You know what that. So if you don't feel that you're holding on to hot coals, there are some questions to be answered, isn't it? Holding on to Islam in akhir zaman would be holding on, like holding on to hot coals. But even if you're holding on to hot coals, if in your heart you are comfortable that you are on the right path, Allah will give you the strength, the courage, the determination to hold on while the rain is falling. Well, I get emails all the time from people who are in a state of despair. Sheikh, I don't know what to do. Tell me what to do. Tell me where to go. What can I do? A state of despair. If you are walking in the right direction, the journey is easy. But when you cross the rock and you're moving in the wrong direction, لَقَدْ لَكِينَا مِنْ سَفَرِنَا هَذَا نَصَرَ, the journey becomes tiresome, wearisome. And so you have an internal sensor, an internal sensor, which will tell you whether your journey that you are walking on is a journey that you are finding easy or difficult. If it's difficult, maybe you've got to go back to the rock. When Musa alayhi salam got the news that the fish had jumped out of the basket over there, he said, this is what we want. So now they traced their steps back to the rock. فَوَجَدَ عَبْدًا مِنْ عِبَادِنَا فَوَجَدَ عَبْدًا مِنْ عِبَادِنَا And there at the rock they found a servant of Allah. This is the man he's looking for. This is the most learned of all men in akhir zaman. And now listen to what Allah says about this, the most learned of all men. آتَيْنَاهُ رَحْمَةً مِنْ عِنْدِنَا وَعَلَّمْنَاهُ مِنْ لَدُنَّ عِلْمًا He doesn't speak only of knowledge. Allah does not speak of knowledge alone, although it is such a profound statement. وَعَلَّمْنَاهُ مِنْ لَدُنَّ عِلْمًا The knowledge came to him directly from me. And so this is knowledge that is internally received, not externally sought. And yet, in addition to speaking about knowledge, Allah says that he gave him rahmah. Why? Why this, allow the big word now, why this juxtaposition of kindness with knowledge? Why? And over there in Surah Al-Rum, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنْفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا For those of you who are not yet married or who are just married like Jamal, and amongst his signs is this, that he created for you from amongst your very selves your mates, that you might dwell with each other, not with pots and pans flying all over the house, but sukoon. Sukoon is peace, sukoon is contentment, sukoon is tranquility. And how does that sukoon come? Sukoon in romance, and sukoon in the world of knowledge. Sukoon in romance, and sukoon in the quest for knowledge. Sukoon in the quest for knowledge. How does it come? وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ mawaddatan wa rahma. Again, the juxtaposition. And he has ordained betwixt your hearts love. And something else with love. Kindness. Kindness. So when there's love and there's kindness, search for that kind of boy to get married to. Search for that kind of girl. When there is love and there is kindness together, then you get sukoon. When there is knowledge and there is kindness with knowledge, then you can climb the world of knowledge. Arrogance cannot sleep on the same bed with knowledge. Arrogance will destroy knowledge. Pride will destroy knowledge. So وَآتَيْنَاهُ رَحْمَةً مِنْ عِنْدِنَا وَعَلَّمْنَاهُ مِنْ لَدُنَّا عِلْمًا. Delivers a very, very important message concerning epistemology. How is knowledge acquired? How is knowledge preserved? How is knowledge advanced? And that is that you must be kind. You must be forgiving. Don't say, I will never forgive her, but Lord, forgive me. Do not be an oppressor. You know, the Indonesian maid, and you pay her the salary that no Malay girl will work for, no Singaporean girl will work for. You pay her the salary of her dog, you are an oppressor. Or the Bangladeshi who's working in the plantation, you know, the oil, palm oil plantations, and you pay him the salary of a dog, you are an oppressor. So long as you are an oppressor, you cannot pursue knowledge. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about this most learned of all men who is located at Majma'ul Bahrain, and who receives knowledge directly from Allah, but who also has kindness at the heart of his personality. He's a forgiving person, he's a kind person, he's a charitable person, he's a loving person. Very important lesson for you now, that you are the beginning of your career. Musa alayhi salam wants to follow him, so he can learn from him. What does he say? A one-eyed man, Dajjal, who sees with only one eye, he's blind in the other eye, it looks like a bulging brick. What does it mean? That tomorrow when Dajjal stands up in Jerusalem, of course he's going to come from Khorasan, you don't have to remind me of that. He's going to stand up in Jerusalem. By my estimate, and I can be wrong, maybe 20, 25 years from now, and I can be wrong, read Jerusalem in the Quran, and he declares, I am the Messiah, which is what's going to happen. And he's going to be a Jew. He's going to be a young man. He's going to be powerful and built. He's up curly here. And he stands up in Jerusalem to declare, I am the Messiah. And when I recognize him, that this is Dajjal, you will say to me, no, he can't be Dajjal because this man has two eyes. And I am suggesting to you that this is not to be understood literally. But please, 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 you do not have to put on boxing gloves because I made that statement. Why? Why can't we discuss matters of knowledge without boxing gloves? Why not? I suggest that the left eye symbolizes knowledge that is externally acquired. And I suggest that the blind right eye symbolizes internal blindness. And the story of Musa alayhi salam and Khidr alayhi salam focuses upon these two sources of knowledge. Musa alayhi salam is now presented, this is not Musa alayhi salam himself, Allah chooses to present him in this form in Surah Al-Kahf, I believe, to send a message to Banu Israel that he is only focusing upon the external form of events and has no knowledge of its internal substance. And so he is temporarily one-eyed. May Allah forgive me if I use language inappropriately. May Allah forgive me. Temporarily. And he wants to follow Khidr alayhi salam to get knowledge from him. What does Khidr alayhi salam say? What is his answer? Innaka lan tastati'a ma'iya sabra. You cannot bear with me with patience. Wa kayfa tasbiru ala ma lam tuhib bihi khubra. And how can you show patience concerning that which lies beyond your capacity to comprehend using your epistemology? This is an epistemological message being sent in Surah Al-Kahf. That the one-eyed cannot bear with patience, but the one who sees with two eyes. I get so many emails. Sheikh, when I talk to my family, they say I'm a fool. They say I'm misguided. When I say to them we should not have bought this house with a bank loan on interest, they say I'm mad. How can you live in the world today without buying a house with a bank loan on interest? When I speak to my family members and I tell them this is Akhir al-Zaman, and we have to study about Dajjal and Magog and Magog and these things, they say, I'm mad. I get these emails all the time. So this is the way you answer. The way Khidr alayhi salam answered Musa alayhi salam. Innaka lan tastati'a ma'iya sabra. Wa kayfa tasbiru ala ma lam tuhit bihi khubra. You will not be able to be a patient. How can you show patience of that which lies beyond your capacity to comprehend? But when you find someone who comes to you humbly seeking knowledge, you don't turn away from such people. You give them time and you guide them, educate them. But when you see them arrogant like that, just turn away. وَإِذَا خَاتَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا. Just turn your way and go your way. But Musa alayhi salam insists, so Khidr alayhi salam said, okay, you can go along with me on this condition. I know this is difficult for a university student to hear. You may accompany me on the condition that you ask no questions. I will respect you. Don't ask no questions. But he just said, I'm the most learned of all men. And now to be told, don't ask any questions. Rather humiliating. I think personally Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sending a message to those arrogant people who declare we are the chosen of the Lord God and heaven is reserved for us. And so he accepts the condition and they travel and then these three events occur. In analyzing these three events, the boat, the boy, the wall. I want to suggest to you that there are multiple messages being sent. And that if we reflect and ponder over it, and if Allah puts Noor into our hearts, we're able to see more in these three events than I am able to do today. So do not be content with one superficial explanation of the boat and of the boy and of the wall. The first event about the boat, at the primary level of analysis, indicates to us that Musa alayhi salam viewed the event from its external form.
and came to a conclusion that what Khidr alayhi salam had done was wrong. But when Khidr alayhi salam viewed the event, not only in terms of its external form, but its internal substance, the knowledge that Allah gave to him, then we understand that what he did was not only right, it was intelligent, it was compassionate. He scuttled the boat of these poor fishermen, boatmen, because there was a king who was coming, who would be seizing people's properties. Ask the American people today. They're sitting on the edge of a pit of fire, and they expect any moment it'll happen, and the riots will come into the United States. That's another subject. So, the difference between this epistemology and this one. With this epistemology, you came to the wrong conclusion, which is what happened to Islamic scholarship on matters pertaining to money. Up to this day, we cannot get the scholars of Islam to recognize that the monetary system which came out of Bretton Woods, in first place, they don't study international monetary economics. No, they don't. It's not taught. In Al-Azhar University, it's not taught to Darul Uloom. The shuyukh don't appear to me to have knowledge of the subject. And since you cannot recognize that the money which came out of Europe, the monetary system which came out of Bretton Woods, and the International Monetary Fund, paper currency, and the electronic money which is about to replace it, and the petrodollar which came in between, were bogus and fraudulent and utterly haram. If your methodology is to study only the external form of the object, you're going to miss the bus in Akhir al-Zaman. And what a terrible, terrible, terrible price you will pay as a scholar of Islam when you misguide the people. It's bogus. It's fraudulent. It's haram. It was constructed by our enemies to rip us off and to enslave us. And they can't recognize it. No, they can't. But if you study the subject using that methodology, then you'll be able to recognize the reality of the event. So this is what happened with the boy. The same thing happened with the boy. And Musa alayhi salam was even more concerned, because remember, he killed a man by accident and suffered for it. But Khidr alayhi salam is able to present the reality of the subject. And the difference between the two is so stark. And then came the wall, and again Musa alayhi salam comes to one conclusion based on this epistemology. And Khidr alayhi salam gives a different conclusion based on that epistemology. And he is correct. And so the message is repeated three times in Surah Al-Kahf. It is the mother of all warnings for those who live in Akhir al-Zaman. For those who live in the age of Dajjal, be careful of your methodology. Because if you have the wrong methodology, you get the wrong conclusion. There are other messages in these three events. And that is that if you live in Akhir al-Zaman, and you've got a lovely boat, mashallah, like a cruiser, $300,000, you're in danger. You're in danger. Because in Akhir al-Zaman, they're going to come after you.
and they'll rob you, they'll seize it from you. And so, low profile is better in articles of man. Sell the Mercedes Benz. Jamal doesn't have to sell his Volvo because he's about 50 years old. Don't live in Damansara Heights. The land alone costs 300,000, or three million ringgits. The land alone, not only the house, the land alone is 3 million ringgits. Or in country heights, or in this heights, or that heights. Your safety and your security in Akhirat Zaman requires you to follow that message and scuttle your boat. Then nobody will come to bother you. There is, we're now taking the analysis to a higher level, and we still have a little time to do that. There is a message located in the second event, that this is not an actual event which is to be judged by Sharia. Because in Sharia, you are not permitted to kill an innocent boy
because tomorrow he will become a George Bush.
No, Sharia does not permit that. So this is not an event to be judged as an actual occurrence subject to the law of the Sharia. No. Rather, there is symbolism here and a message being sent that in the age of Dajjal, the young ones are going to be targeted. And at the age when they're still young and teenagers, they will be so manipulated, so brainwashed, so programmed that they can become zombies. When you see them and they're swaying like this, and you are, why is he dancing? What's wrong with him? And he's like, oh, you didn't see the wire going up to the ears on this side? He's listening to music. He's listening to music. And then you're driving with him and he suddenly starts talking. Who is he talking to? He doesn't have a Ford, no hand Ford, but he's talking. Oh, sorry, not he, she. Because she's in hijab. And you didn't see the Ford already there. In Akhir al-Zaman, they're going to be hooked. They're going to be hooked to Dajjal's music. They're going to be hooked to Dajjal's electronic gadgetry. I had four or five people in my sitting room two or three nights ago. And as I raised my head from my desk to look at them, I saw this one. I saw that one. I saw that one. I said to myself, is this some kind of a magic? They all have different kinds of electronic equipment. And some of these equipments you have to push your hand this way and that way and that way. And others you have to do this. And so they get hooked. And if the day comes and they don't have this gadget, they might have to take them to a hospital. You see a young person moving in that direction, and you as a father and mother cannot get your son or daughter to return to the right path. No, mommy, I'm going to shack up with him. We don't need marriage anymore. Then, although you are father and mother, the time will come when you'll have to cut off your ties from those who are blood related. Because if you do not cut off your ties, they will drag you into the pit of fire. That is the message from the killing of the boy. And then comes the wall. And if you have wealth in Akhiru Zaman, who can you trust? Who can you trust? Today there might be one or two. Tomorrow there'll be nobody. You can't trust anybody. That's the rule. That's why we want to build a Muslim village in the remote countryside. And we have with us here tonight the man who's the head of my group of students here in Malaysia. They already bought land already, mashallah. And soon they're clearing the land now, so they're going to start planting food crops and put animals on the land. And then some kampung houses are going to go up. But ultimately we want a Muslim village in a place where you cannot use a cell phone. When you cannot use a cell phone, now we know we're out of range. So what do you do with your wealth? How do you protect it? When there's no one you can trust. So what he did was to dig a hole and bury his wealth. If you bury ringgits, 20 years later, when you go to look for it, it'll all be gone into the mud. I suggest you might be in our dirham and bury that instead of paper. And because this wall was crumbling, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked him to repair the wall, sending a message to us about protecting our wealth in Akhiru Zaman. I want to turn now to the last stage of my analysis of these three events, and these are only my opinion. And when I give my opinion, I'll be disappointed in you if you accept it. I've said it time and again. Please do not accept my opinion when I offer an opinion, out of respect for your own intellect. Do not accept my opinions unless and until you are convinced that it is correct. Can I do all of that? So if they accept my opinions after that, are you going to blame me? And you can put on YouTube, don't listen to a man who says, shame on you, shame on you, shame on you. That's not part of our intellectual culture. Don't listen to Imran Hussein. It's never been a part of our intellectual culture. No. The scuttling of the boat can be a message. And this is the boat of Islam. And it is Akhir al-Zaman, the boat of Islam will be scuttled. And as a consequence, Islam will not be on center stage of the affairs of the world. But that scuttled boat will be repaired when Imam al-Mahdi comes. And then it will sail again. It will sail again. The hadith is that Sahih Bukhari, that the Umran, my name is Imran, this is Umran, of Bayt al-Maqdis of Jerusalem, would be at that time when Medina would be kharab, desolate. That's where we are today. Medina in a state of desolation. Medina playing absolutely no role whatsoever on the stage of politics, on economics, the world affairs, none whatsoever. But Jerusalem is now center stage in the world. That's what he said. That the flourishing state of Jerusalem would be at that time when Medina would be desolate. And then he said that at that time when Medina would be desolate, that will be the time when the great wars will start. I expect it to start sometime in the next few months. And then he said, when the great wars take place, that is the time that Constantinople will be conquered. Have you not read the hadith? How could it be 600 years ago? And when Constantinople is conquered, that is the time the Khuruj of Dajjal will take place. Meaning Dajjal will appear now in human form. And so the boat is going to resurface. At the moment it is still scuttling, but it's going to resurface. That is one possible analysis, but you don't have to accept it. The boy's head is taken off. And if we are talking about the boat of the Ummah, then the boy also represents the Ummah. And the head is taken off, we're going to lose the Khilafah. But Allah knows best. These are only an opinion of mine. And then comes the treasure, which is Islam, which is buried. Allah is buried. It's being protected. No one can steal it. And above the treasure, there's a wall. And when you see that wall crumbling, as it is crumbling now, then you must do what Khidr alayhi salam did. Do what you can to try to restore it. In other words, do what you can to restore Islam. Since it cannot be restored at the macro level, why can't you restore it at the micro level? And that is what we are trying to do. Repairing the wall is the Muslim village in the remote countryside with an emir and with a jama'ah. And here, the Sufi and the Salafi were living together as brothers. Oh yeah. Because in our masjid, you have only the Quran and Sunnah. Nothing else. Anything which is not based on the Quran and the universally accepted Sunnah, we will not allow it in the masjid. No. You want to celebrate the birth anniversary of the Prophet, you've been doing it for 1,000 years. We say, this is not in the Quran. This is not in the Sunnah. But we are not going to take up boxing gloves to give you an hour. Not this people. We're not fighting over this. If you want to do that, go ahead. We say, brother, in order to keep the unity of the Jama'ah, whatever you have which is not based on the Quran and Sunnah, could you kindly keep it in the private and don't bring it in the public? That's all. And we'll be able to live together as a united community. And when he comes, because you are doing something in private, and he starts shouting bid'ah and haram, we'll throw him out of that village faster than Federal Express. Because you are an agent of fitna. We are a people who try to repair the wall. The treasure is under the wall. And tomorrow when Nabi Isa alayhi salam returns, tomorrow when Imam al-Mahdi emerges, that treasure is going to come out. Brothers and sisters, sons and daughters, students, this has been a limited analysis of Khidr alayhi salam in Akhir al-Zaman and his link with Dajjal. I want to end by asking those of you who feel sufficiently interested in this topic to read this book, Surah Al-Kahf in the Modern Age, and then pursue your study of the subject. And may Allah bless you, that you may be able to extend the frontiers of knowledge even more than Allah has blessed me to do in this limited time and in this limited way. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا يا مولانا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم.